Okay. Thank you very much. Thanks for all the nice words said today. You know, you feel a little bit like as if you're at your own funeral. People are excessively nice, of course, at such times. Well, thank you anyway. It was fun. I'm glad my wife was here. I just wish my mother was also here. She'd be very happy. What I want to talk about is some thoughts I had before I became a central banker and ceased to have the right to think or to speak. So think of this as my last attempt to say something, and that's why it's the logo is Chicago Booth, not the Reserve Bank of India. These are indeed views that were personal and before I took this office. So let me give you a sense of where I'm going. I'm going to talk about the environment before the crisis, and I want to argue that the kind of demand we had before the crisis could perhaps have been unsustainable demand. And that's something very important to remember as we try and get back to the pre-crisis environment, that perhaps the pace of growth, which was largely debt-fueled, is indeed hard to return to. But I want to not dwell on that, but focus on what happened afterwards, that we had tremendous panic and a market breakdown. And clearly there were tremendous efforts made by the banks, the central bankers, to fix the markets, fix the institutions, and many of them worked, which is why I think today we're not in the second Great Depression, that we're in a slow but much better environment than we were then. But I want to argue that the next step, which was how to revive growth, and again, the pressure to return to the kind of growth that we had before, may be a place where, to some extent, action has outstripped our knowledge of economics. I want to talk through some of what we're trying to do, talk about why, in fact, we may not have been as successful as in the past, but more generally end with some thinking about what this means for the global economy. And I want to argue that we seem to be in a situation where we're sort of doomed to inflate bubbles elsewhere, to pull ourselves out of growth, and in some sense, the right policy in this kind of environment seems to be to resist trying to boost your own demand, rely on the demand of others. If everybody does this, this leads to a world which grows suboptimally. And if we are to move away from that kind of structure, we have to think about global monetary and financial arrangements, and we haven't done enough thinking on that in recent years. So that is where I want to go. Let me start first with what we had before the crisis. And clearly, we had a lot of debt-fueled demand. While it was happening, it was easy to rationalize it as the growth of financial markets, what some people, Bob Shiller, famously called the democratization of finance. Finance was spreading more widely. We had strong new institutions. We had better disclosure. All this led to the spread of finance, spread of borrowing, and that was felt to be a good thing. And indeed, it was a good thing. It helped new firms emerge. It helped a lot of activity which wouldn't have happened otherwise. But the question is, did it go too far? And of course, since the crisis, we have a lot of models which describe how there might be excessive leverage which builds up in the system because there are externalities one doesn't take full cognizance of, variety of models by people in this room. But also one could argue that there may have been an element of politics in what was going on in an environment of relatively slow growth where you could not reproduce the growth that took place in countries in the post-war years. Perhaps the way to add a little boost to growth, a little oomph, was to rely on increasing debt, increasing leverage. And I have argued in my book that housing in the United States was a easy answer to the problem of falling or stagnant median wages and the growing inequality. By pushing housing, you created a situation where people borrowed against the house, didn't feel that they were borrowing their way into debt, especially as house prices rose, and this became good not just for the households, but also for bankers and politicians in general. But there could be other explanations, and there have been many over time. We could also argue something similar was happening in the euro area, that the opportunities opened up by euro integration to cheap finance essentially led to overborrowing in the euro periphery, some of it fueled by lending from the euro core. And the point really is that in recent years, we've started asking the question, can there be too much debt? Can, even in a voluntary situation where there's no coercion, can entities overborrow? And a variety of models have made that point in a variety of ways. Regardless of where it came, we got a crisis driven by overborrowing. And remember, and this is a point I'll come to later, there were many countries that benefited from this. Not necessarily the countries that were borrowing too much and getting themselves into trouble, but the countries that supplied the demand, that allowed these countries to consume. In the United States, for example, one could argue the emerging markets benefited tremendously as they relied on external demand and no longer had to boost domestic demand in order to grow. They could rely on external demand. No wonder, over the 10 years before the crisis, emerging markets started looking like the paragons of virtue, with low government debt, low fiscal deficits, and high external reserves. Let me come back to the industrial countries. The first sort of reaction to the crisis was to fix the problems. And I think a variety of innovative steps were taken from the U.S. Fed, TAFT, DARP, a variety of programs which succeeded in essentially putting a bottom to the financial sector downturn, as also from the ECB side, SMP, LTRO, and OMT. So a variety of measures, innovative, quite appropriate in hindsight, worked well, bailed out the financial system. I should mention in passing that, you know, used to have strong debates at Chicago on whether we should bail out the financial system. And it turned out that the division more or less ran along the lines of whether you'd done any work on banking or not. A variety of people who had worked in banking who said, yes, you should. Don't let the financial banking system collapse. You can't retrieve it quickly. A variety of people who said, no, let it go. You're bailing out the bankers, terrible for capitalism, and so on. Now, Luigi was on one side of the fence then, the side which thought, let the banks collapse. I'm glad to see that he's come to the other side since then. But actually, I will nuance that. But because I don't think in your model there's any incentive or reason to save the bank, because if the bank goes under, if you substitute through some transfer to the liquidity, those who need liquidity, you've done the right thing by them. The organization itself is important only for the claim structure that it offers, but there's no durability to the organization. Nothing is lost by letting the banking system collapse, but compensating the people who lose out. Of course, I think in the work that Doug and I have done, there is some organizational value to the banks. But be that as it may, my sense is central bankers are deservedly heroes and have got the acclaim from doing that that they truly deserve. But the next step was, in the presence of fiscal constraints, and given that a variety of political difficulties made structural reforms hard to do, or even in some sense, because these were industrial countries, less productive, at least according to some people, the focus turned to monetary policy as a way to restore growth. And the sense was, we need to bring real interest rates down as low as possible. Of course, if we try and do that, we get hit by the zero lower bound. in which case we have to find new ways, because nominal interest rates cannot be reduced below zero, we have to find new innovative ways of bringing real interest rates as far down as they should go. I remember a piece by the San Francisco Fed which said that in the U.S., the equilibrium real interest rate was -6%. And if you want to get it there, clearly you have to do something extraordinary. What I'm going to talk about a little bit now is both the theory as well as the practice of these ultra or these unconventional monetary policies, and ask questions. I don't know the answers, but let me at least ask the questions. So the theory behind these ultra low interest rates is essentially the neutral rate to get the at which the economy would be at equilibrium, close to full sustainable employment equilibrium. That neutral rate is strongly negative. In other words, that for some reason you have to push real interest rates really low in order to get people to invest, to consume, such that, in fact, demand equals supply at that point. The problem, of course, is in a post-crisis environment, does this really work? I mean, in some sense, the idea is because this is post-crisis, the real interest rate is strongly negative. But you could argue that given the elements of the crisis, it may in fact be hard to restore demand through a strongly negative real interest rate or even a moderately negative real interest rate. Take, for example, corporate investment. Why is corporate investment so low? I mean, it depends on why it is so low. Supposing, for example, credit is hard to come by because banks are broke, banks don't want to take any risk, banks don't have access to finance that easily, and even from the perspective of corporations, great policy uncertainty, where taxes will fall in a fiscally constrained environment, create a hesitation to invest. Now, in that kind of environment, it may be hard to spur growth simply by moving the interest rate. There are other factors which are constraining growth, and to really get action. I'm not saying there's no interest rate at which you could get action, but that interest rate could be so negative that it's hard to achieve. Essentially, through that large negative interest rate, you're offering a subsidy to investment, a huge subsidy to investment. Is that subsidy, in a sense, feasible? That would be a very relevant question. Similarly, part of the idea is, okay, let's not get investment going, but let's get consumption going. And consumption, of course, suffers from the problem that the guys who were consuming before crisis are typically the ones hardest hit by the crisis, by the excess debt levels. In the U.S., the household that borrowed against their houses now are sitting on underwater mortgages. So how do you get these guys to spend? Very hard. And so, models like Egerton and Krugman say, you know, forget about these guys. They're not going to be able to spend. They're too highly indebted. Let's get the guys who didn't spend before the crisis to spend. In other words, the savers before the crisis, let's get them to spend more. And the way to get anybody who saves to spend more is reduce the interest rate so that they have very little incentive to save and they go out and spend. So you're thinking about 60-year-olds who were saving before the crisis. Now you want to get them to buy BMWs and Porsches. And so you reduce the real interest rate and they go out and spend like drunken sailors. Problem, of course, with that view is why were they saving in the first place before the crisis? And, some have argued, including me, that if they were trying to save, for example, to meet retirement needs, the crisis itself may have hit their wealth holdings so that they find that in order to get to that level of savings that they had in mind before, they actually have to save more. And if they have to save more and they're more focused on fixed income investments, the fact that you have really low interest rates may make them save even more. Obviously, I'm talking about income and substitution effects, and what matters is which dominates. And it is quite possible to envisage a situation where the guys who traditionally consumed can't consume anymore because they're hit by debt overload post-crisis. The guys who weren't hit now save even more because you've reduced their rate of return. And the net result is lower interest rates are actually contractionary in terms of demand rather than expansionary. I'm not saying this is necessarily the model of the world that is right. I'm saying that there's enough question about the slow pace of demand recovery that we should consider alternative models of what's going on and wonder whether lower and lower interest rates are in fact the solution or part of the problem. And I say at this point, I don't know. Let me then move to, let's assume that they are in fact the solution, that we want really low interest rates. But the question is, do they work as effectively as other methods? For example, one of the problems in the United States that my colleague Amir Sufi has documented is debt fuel demand was highly localized. In certain areas like Las Vegas, a lot of consumption based on high home equity withdrawals and spending. And post-crisis, those are the places that are in deep trouble. On the other hand, places like New York City, relatively less disruption from the boom before the crisis, relatively less increase in demand, and post-crisis, not much disruption. Well, the interest rate tool is very, very blunt, and it tries to raise demand across the board, but demand across the board may not be helpful except for traded goods. For non-traded goods like services, which are quite localized, it may be relatively unhelpful. So the question is, if you had a dollar to spend, would you spend it through monetary policy or would you spend it through fiscal policy? And my sense is in these kinds of post-crisis environments, one could well argue that targeted fiscal policy may be better. Of course, part of the problem is fiscal policy may be gridlocked or, in fact, may be difficult to do at this time for a variety of political reasons. Again, post-crisis, the political environment is much more fraught, and getting the right policies may, in fact, be difficult. So a lot of economists have been advocating debt write-offs in the areas that have been that had the tremendous run-up. But, of course, this is politically very difficult in the United States, has not happened. And even unemployment insurance at some point loses effectiveness, and there's been a lot of question. Let me turn then to implementation. Okay, let's assume that no other policies work. Fiscal policy doesn't work, that interest rates are the tool, and we want strongly negative real interest rates. Well, how do you actually achieve it? In the way that central banks have tried to do it, really two broad approaches. From the Fed, given the relatively contained inflation, the trick has been, let us find a way to reduce rates without raising inflationary expectations. The way they have tried to go ahead with this is two. Forward guidance, whereby they signal that the Fed will stay low for long and will not raise rates before certain conditions are met. Those conditions could be time. We won't raise rates before 2016. Or they could be state contingent. We won't raise rates before unemployment falls below 6.5%. Both those methods have been followed by central banks. The key concern here from a theoretical perspective, I would argue, is a concern that markets have been raising recently, which is what is the degree of commitment that that you have, most particularly in the case of the Bank of England, whether, in fact, with all the knockouts that are in place, whether the central bank will act as advertised and keep rates low for the desired period. Again, I think this is an open question and it's something worth investigating. With forward guidance, how do you get credibility that you'll do what you say and not back off when the time comes, which the credibility literature has long pointed out as an issue with central bank. The second way that you try and keep you bring down real interest rates is by bringing down the long-term nominal interest rate, and you do that by asset purchases. And here again, people have raised questions. Of course, as Woodford points out, if you internalize everything in the economy, asset purchases should not have any effect. Just because the government buys some assets from individuals, so long as you see the whole picture of portfolios that the economy holds, the fact that the central bank buys something in its portfolio, it's still contained within the economy, and therefore that shouldn't affect anybody's behavior. This is a form of Ricardian equivalence that would negate the effects of large-scale asset purchases. But we've seen large-scale asset purchases have effect. So what is going on? Well, perhaps Ricardian equivalence doesn't hold. Perhaps, in fact, markets are indeed segmented. And if the central bank buys long-term bonds out of your portfolio, let's assume these bonds are riskier than short-term bonds. You now have space in your portfolio to go out and buy other long-term bonds, which should push down the yields of long-term bonds, push up by pushing up their price, which in fact will lower yields and therefore allow you to push down interest rates. That's one way it could work. It will also push down the yields on other risky assets or increase the prices of other risky assets. And the idea is the price of risky assets increase, then perhaps on the real side, people who issue these risky assets will have the incentive to go out and make risky investments, which is important for growth in the economy. Now, this is the theory. What is surprising is, given this theory, how much of an effect talk about tapering has on bond prices. Why do I say that? Because the theory is really about the stock of asset holdings. It's about where the stock is held, who holds the stock. So the fact that I'm going to taper my bond purchases at the Fed from $85 billion to maybe $75 or $60 billion should not make such a big difference in the long-term bond holdings that the Fed was going to have. It's going to make a moderate difference, but not a huge difference. In other words, unless people thought the Fed was going to buy assets till infinity, the fact that the Fed announces a tapering should make only a small difference in the total stock that the Fed was going to end up with, and therefore should not have a huge effect on asset prices, at least according to the portfolio balance idea. But somehow the flow, rather than the stock, seems to have an important effect, and that's something that I think we don't fully understand. We need to have models where the flow of asset purchases matters about as much as the stock does. Of course, I think we need better theories here of why this matters and how it matters. Now, this is as far as for example, the Fed goes with its unconventional monetary policy. I think more difficult than the Fed's job is the Bank of Japan's job, because for the Fed, inflationary expectations are relatively well contained, and the Fed doesn't really want to upset or disturb those inflationary expectations. For the Bank of Japan, however, the job is really, even while keeping nominal interest rates relatively contained, they want to increase inflationary expectations and thereby bring down the real rate of return, bring down the equilibrium long real rate. The problem the Bank of Japan has is, as they've acknowledged in multiple fora, that if the inflationary expectations are raised too fast or too much, bond prices can fall significantly as nominal yields rise. Right? So what they want is to keep nominal yields relatively stable so that bond portfolios don't suffer a big fall in value, which may then cause problems in their debt markets. Essentially, they want to keep bond prices relatively stable even while increasing inflationary expectations through this bond purchase. And this is really a very difficult very difficult balancing act. Thus far, they have managed to do it, but it is, in a sense, a tremendous feat if they pull it off, and I hope they will. So that's, in other words, the bottom line here is the central banks with these unconventional monetary policies are trying to do some extraordinary things, and whether they succeed, how they succeed, we don't have a lot of theory. We don't have a lot to say about how it will work. And of course, we need more work in these areas. But I think as far as the unintended consequences of these unconventional policies go, we do have some evidence. For example, Jeremy Stein has talked about the risk-taking that might take place in an environment of low interest rates that are held low for long, and there's been a lot of good work done at the ECB documenting these factors. Essentially, when you have very low interest rates, there are a variety of reasons why it makes sense for entities to take on more risk. A classic example is if you're an insurance company and you've got policies which require a fixed payout in an environment of low interest rates, when you know you're toast. If you invest in safe securities, you won't be able to meet your payouts. You have an incentive to gamble for resurrection by taking on more risk. And there is evidence, growing evidence, that in fact some insurance companies have been doing that. Now, of course, you may argue this is precisely the point about unconventional policies. You want to encourage entities to take risk because then that will allow real risk-taking, which will create the conditions for stronger economic growth because investment will take place, etc. I'm not sure we know that last link exists, that in fact when financial markets take more risk, that this translates into real risk-taking. And it may be that there is a separation between the financial risk-taking and the real risk-taking, that financial risk-taking can happen in markets but doesn't translate into banks being willing to take more risk, more credit risk of one kind or the other, in an environment where banks are trying to build up capital, where they're deleveraging, where there's limited bank lending. There may be no connection between the financial market risk-taking and the real risk-taking, or limited connection, especially if investment is held back by other factors such as policy uncertainty. So you may get the financial risk-taking, the re-emergence, for example, in the United States of covenant-light loans, which were at a height before the crisis and are reaching those heights once again. You may get that without the commensurate real sector risk-taking, which would be necessary for stronger economic growth. So that's one set of unintended consequences. Another set of unintended consequences, which I have closer experience of recently, is spillovers, cross-border capital flows, and asset price booms. Now, the conventional response to capital flowing into your country from other places is you do countercyclical policy. Now, typically monetary tightening has mixed effects. You're raising interest rates, makes it more attractive to buy fixed income assets in your country post the raising. Not clear that that works entirely as advertised. But certainly the prescription from the fund to countries facing capital flows as first line of defense is fiscal tightening. Don't, in a sense, take in the capital flows and increase demand. You may have problems down the line as you have credit booms, asset price booms, and trouble. Do fiscal tightening when the money is coming in. Now, of course, this is easier said than done. When an emerging market gets a whole lot of money when the currency is appreciating, at that point, the politicians are beating themselves on beating their chest, saying, we're so good, the world recognizes we're so good, our growth is strong, and the money is pouring in. At that point, there's very little incentive to do fiscal tightening, very little incentive. We've seen, even in industrial countries, it's very hard to follow counter-cyclical policies at such times. Instead, the incentive is to take the growth and say, you're responsible for it. It's not easy money that's responsible for the growth. It's your wonderful policies which have changed the environment and attracted this capital. Counter-cyclical policy is extremely difficult, especially in emerging markets which don't have the kinds of fiscal and monetary institutions that industrial countries have, but certainly also in industrial countries where when the capital was coming the other way from the emerging markets, that too was not sent back out, it was absorbed, as, for example, in the savings glut situation that the United States faced during the lead-up to the crisis. So the problem really is the conventional answer, tighten fiscal policy, is easier said than done. What about, prudential norms, including capital controls? Even that is hard, because that is essentially less less effective. We've seen that happen in Spain. Spain was the central bank. Spain's central bank initiated dynamic provisioning that was thought as something that was countercyclical, that would help Spain when it got into trouble, and certainly it has helped. But has it helped Spain avert the construction boom and the crisis? Probably not. So prudential policies may help at the margin, but may not be effective enough to prevent the kinds of booms and busts that happen when you get capital flowing in through every crevice. And ultimately, how do you deal with this? It becomes extremely hard. In terms of the problems with let me pass over this. Let me go to the last two problems I see. For the industrial countries themselves, when the central banks take on a greater role through these unconventional means, there is a standard problem of central banks doing a lot, which is it takes away the pressure on the politicians to do what is necessary. And political action, as everybody in this room recognizes, is endogenous. The fear of a hanging thread tends to focus minds, and people do what is necessary as it gets closer to the due date. By the acting, the central banks take off some of the pressure. Put differently, when the central banks say they're the only game in town and therefore have to act, they become the only game in town. There is no other game because everybody then is willing to wait. This is a problem. This is a problem because you're damned if you do and damned if you don't. If you stand by, perhaps the political actors don't get their act together and you have deeper problems. But if you act, you take the pressure of them to act, and again, you may get into deeper difficulty. In general, you become more intertwined, and that is a problem whether in industrial countries or emerging markets. And finally, of course, there is the issue of exit, which we are confronted by for example, in the United States. And the traditional, remedy for exit, not for the countries that are exiting, but for the countries that receive the capital flows, the emerging markets that receive the capital flows, and where it's flowing out, is let the exchange rate adjust. Let the exchange rate adjust, and all will be well. Problem, of course, with that simple prescription is that it is complicated partly by leverage, partly by the fact that there are multiple equilibria in the exchange market. And if you're willing to stand by and wait for the exchange rate to adjust, you may get a certain amount of overshooting, which then creates a lot of problem for the levered entities, but also may take some time to be undone, and in the process create other problems. So I think that when you get into something, we also have to worry about the way you exit. And of course, we've seen in recent months that the prospect of exit can create problems for the countries that have received capital flows. Of course, we should say now, you should have handled those capital flows better. But given the difficulties of handling them in the appropriate way, I think we have to recognize that this is not a problem only for the emerging markets. It was a problem when the industrial countries were recipients of capital flows. It is now a problem for emerging markets because they absorb the capital flows when the industrial countries were following unconventional policies. It is a problem that could recur for the industrial countries if post this crisis the emerging markets start building reserves again and push the capital flows back to the industrial countries. In other words, we need to solve this problem, and we need to take a more practical view of it than, don't absorb the capital flows, follow counter-cyclical policies. So the point, I think, and let me put this as a broader view from emerging markets, given that I come from an emerging market, to some extent, our problems, our difficulties today are clearly a result of the excess stimulus that we gave to our economies post the industrial country crisis in 2007-2008. We were not hit as badly as we thought we were. We had in India, for example, 3 stimulus packages. There's probably 2 stimulus packages too much relative to what we needed. We had strong growth through a combination of monetary and fiscal stimulus. But I would say this is a more general situation. You see a variety of emerging markets in difficulty today, and I think the problem is faced with capital inflows, there tends to be pro-cyclicality in policy. It's not just an emerging market problem, it's also an industrial country problem. So clearly, exhortations to put our house in order so that we can ride out volatility are absolutely right economically speaking, but practically, they're relatively unhelpful because the politics just doesn't admit of counter-cyclicality at the right times. So what is the answer? My fear is the answer emerging markets will take away from this episode of stress is the right answer is not to run current account deficits, don't contribute to world demand, instead build a very safe structure by building reserves, focus on export-led growth, build your own buffers, and rely on exporting to be stable. If that is the answer many emerging markets take away, given that they're going to become more significant parts of the world economy, there is a very real question. Is the world condemned to slow growth and to increasing indebtedness in industrial countries as attempts to increase exports, attempts to grow through selling to the emerging markets, which in a better world would be the right way to grow for the industrial countries out of their current malaise, gets thwarted by a reaction from the emerging markets which says we don't want to destabilize our longer run growth by absorbing the capital which is coming out from your countries. So I think the answer to all this is we have to break this cycle where we're exporting crises. We had the emerging market crises in the 90s. They were then exported to the industrial countries, which basically, as the savings glut went to the industrial countries, the industrial countries then started providing world demand. Emerging markets put their house in order. And, of course, that ended unhappily for the industrial countries. Post the industrial country crisis, the emerging markets spent, and regardless of how they spent, China, Brazil, India, they're facing a variety of difficulties now. Is the answer going to be yet another cycle, this time from the emerging markets putting their house in order, saving, and again reflecting capital back to the industrial countries? Really, the answer is we need to rethink crisis responses. We need to think about the dangers of overstimulation. We need to think about the dangers of sending capital across borders and prompting excess demand elsewhere. We need to think about the unsustainability of growth, which is restored through quick stimulus, and think about the prospects for longer-term, strong, sustainable growth. Part of the answer would, I think, lie in trying to reform the international monetary and financial architecture. I say both monetary and financial, we have to think about central bank policy. To what extent should it internalize spillovers? Already, domestic-oriented central bank policy is difficult. So why would you include international spillovers in consideration? It's going to be difficult, but my sense is, given the nature of cross-border capital flows, that is something we have to start thinking about. And of course, on financial architecture, are our multilateral institutions strong enough to deal with the consequences of global capital flows, or do we need new arrangements that don't have the kind of stigma that today sort of is associated with certain kinds of borrowing? Do we need global reserve pools? How do we achieve that in a way that's more effective than the current arrangement? Or alternatively, is the solution everyone on their own bottom? We all focus on how our own growth can be sustainable in the long run, neither a borrower nor a lender be, and we lose the benefits of running current account deficits for growth across the world. So that's where I want to end. Thank you very much. And I think I've posed more questions than answers, but that's the state of my thinking. Thank you.
So thank you very much for this exciting tour d'horizon and discussion of monetary policy in the aftermath of the crisis. And my takeaway from this talk, among very many other things, is that it's equally important to have the right answers, but also to ask the right questions. Given our schedule, we have time to address a couple of questions from the floor. Mr. Ramstorff.
My name is Detlef Ramstorff. I'm with Deutsche Bank, but I'm a former central banker also. And I was a little bit puzzled by the beginning and the end of your speech, your presentation. In the end, you said the response to the crisis could lead to new crisis. Indeed, I would follow that argument. Not the least because of the questions you have raised concerning low interest rates and their consequences and so forth. We have already a debate in this country about the risks for example, pensions and what have you, and how can you invest in sensible assets. Are there already certain bubbles in certain asset classes and so forth? But in the beginning, you said the central bankers were the heroes. How does that go together?
Yeah, I said they were heroes for preventing the financial system from collapsing. And I said more questions about the second part of the agenda, which is restoring growth. I think the jury is still out on that. And that's where, you know, there are trade-offs. If they were successful in raising real growth, then that's a positive. And certainly there are studies, some from the Fed, which show that absent unconventional policy, real growth would have been lower. If that's right, then that's certainly a positive. On the negative are, studies, commentary, some again from the Fed, but elsewhere, ECB, showing that long periods of low rates do create financial system stresses, which could set the conditions for another crisis. So that's where I'm saying we know less about the second half. I am willing, again, there might be some people who disagree, I'm willing to say that the first point, saving the financial system, was absolutely essential, and they did it. They did it for the most part right.
There. Can you please take the micro?
Yeah. I would have a question on the nominal anchor for emerging market central banks at this juncture. You basically argue very forcefully that a lot of emerging markets are running very high external deficits as a consequence of the unconventional monetary policies in the north that now likely will have to be reduced. So is there a role for the exchange rate as a nominal anchor in an environment where many emerging markets will likely require a steep adjustment in the real exchange rate?
Let me first say that I wasn't indicating that emerging markets ran a large deficit only because of unconventional monetary policy. I think it was an aid, but not necessarily the only thing that happened. I think there's slow growth, many of them post-crisis, many of them indulged in excessive stimulus, which they recognized only later, and, of course, capital inflows to fund that the deficits that arose as a result were helpful and enabled them to run larger deficits. And so it's a combination of things. I don't hold emerging markets a victim to external circumstances. My sense is ultimately that emerging markets have to focus on the internal sort of structure of the economy. And I would argue that a better anchor for them in these circumstances is basically domestic inflation and to try and contain domestic inflation, that might be better than trying to focus on an external anchor in this kind of environment.
One last question. Yeah.
Thank you. I found the last point extremely inspiring about international financial architecture, and my question is, how realistic is that politically, and what is the role that especially emerging market banks or central banks or policymakers can play in this discussion?
Well, I think the first step is to start having the discussion. I think it is a difficult discussion because clearly the mandates of industrial country central banks are set political environment has a historical tradition, and historically it was important and beneficial to focus on domestic conditions. Going forward, I think the external consequences are large, and we thought the exchange rate was the way that countries' economies were separated. So allow the exchange rate to adjust to allow yourself to have independent monetary policy, right? And so that was the claim. And I think that worked maybe for a while, but with cross-border capital flows and leverage, that prescription is becoming much harder. And so I think it's time to have a discussion, to open a discussion. I don't see this as a 2-year process or a 3-year process. But I think in a world which is integrated by capital flows, monetary policy is carried from one country to every nook and crevice, more from the large countries than from the small countries. And so in that sense, I think starting to have the debate and thinking about these consequences. Now, let me say that large country central banks do take into account the external consequences of their policies. But they're not mandated to do that. And as a result, we have heard authorities from different countries say it's not in our mandate. So we really can't take the spillover effects into account. But the spillover effects are important, and not just through the effects on growth for your own country, but are important for effects on growth elsewhere. And as I said, one lesson that could be learned and should not be learned by the emerging markets is look across the world. Which are the emerging markets that have been immune to recent problems? The countries that ran either surpluses or small deficits, as well as the countries that are sitting on enormous reserves, right? I think India with $280 billion is comfortable. But the question is, should we raise it? And I think this kind of question is best answered in a multilateral setting rather than let each country do what is optimal for itself, but suboptimal for the world.
Okay, these were very nice closing remarks. I would like to close this session. Thank very much for all the speakers for very interesting, highly challenging ideas, thoughts on very many areas in the field of liquidity, banking, and monetary policy. Would like to close the session and move immediately without any break onto the next policy session and ask my colleague Michaelis Jaeses to take over. Thank you very much.